The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Well, good evening and welcome to our Maundy Thursday vigil. On this night, we remember Jesus' Last Supper with his disciples. We remember the way he humbly washed their feet, giving an example for them to follow. We remember Jesus' new commandment that his disciples should love one another in the same way that he had loved them and was about to give his life for them. This evening we watch and pray with Jesus as the sun goes down and as the darkness gathers. And so we come to our prayers of penitence, seeking the Lord's forgiveness for our failings. Our Lord Jesus Christ says, "If you love me, keep my commandments. Unless I wash you, you have no part in me." So let us confess our sins to Almighty God against his love and ask him to cleanse us. The response to the words, "Lord, have mercy," is, "Lord, have mercy, mercy." Please do join in with me. Have mercy on us, O God, in your great goodness. According to the abundance of your compassion, blot out our offences. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Against you only have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Purge us from our sins, and we shall be clean. Wash us, and we shall be whiter than snow. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. And so may the Father forgive us by the death of his Son, and strengthen us to live in the power of the Spirit all our days. Amen. And the Collect, the Church's prayer for this Maundy Thursday. God our Father, you have invited us to share in the supper which your Son gave to his Church, to proclaim his death until he comes. May he nourish us by his presence and unite us in his love, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
The Old Testament lesson is taken from the book of Exodus. The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt, "This month is to be for you the first month of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel that on the 10th day of this month, each man is to take a lamb for his family, one for each household. If any household is too small for a whole lamb, they must share one with their nearest neighbor, having taken into account the number of people there are. You are to determine the amount of lamb needed in accordance with what each person will eat. This is how you are to eat it, with your cloak tucked into your belt, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It is the Lord's Passover. On that same night I will pass through Egypt and strike down the firstborn of both people and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord. The blood will be a sign for you on the houses where you are, and when I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you are to commemorate for the generations to come. You shall celebrate it as a lasting festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance. This is the word of the Lord." The second lesson is taken from the first letter of Paul to the Corinthians. "For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" This is the word of the Lord.
I'm
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John. Glory to you, O Lord. Now, before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during the supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. He came to Simon Peter, who said to him, "Lord, are you going to wash my feet?" Jesus answered, "You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand." Peter said to him, "You will never wash my feet." Jesus answered, "Unless I wash you, you have no share with me." Simon Peter said to him, "Lord, not my feet only, but also my hands and my head." Jesus said to him, "One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean. And you are clean, though not all of you." For he knew that one was to betray him. And for this reason, he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet, had put on his robe, and had returned to the table, Jesus said to them, "Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your teacher and Lord, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example that you should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one that sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." When he had gone out, Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God has been glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself, and will glorify him at once. Little children, I am with you only a little while longer. You will look for me, and as I said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another, just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another."
Lord, in these challenging and uncertain times, I ask that your peace will reign in this situation. May the words spoken today provide comfort to those who hear it. As Easter approaches and we hear about Jesus' suffering, death and resurrection, let this remind us all about how wonderful you are and how nothing is so big or insurmountable for you to overcome. Amen. As Easter approaches, this is a very special time in the Christian year where we look back and remember the death and resurrection of Jesus. In the days leading up to that event, we see a real turnaround in how Jesus is received. From being feted as he arrives in Jerusalem, to eventually being betrayed by one of his closest companions and condemned by his own people. Maundy Thursday, as one of the most important days in Holy Week, is where we commemorate not only the Last Supper, which we remember each time we take communion, but it is also on this day that we remember how Jesus washed the feet of all his disciples. The fact that the Son of God was willing to humble himself in this manner is something which would appear surprising to us even now today. And to Peter, at least, was something which he found extremely difficult to reconcile. In our world, it is very rare that we see those in positions of authority and power willing to humble themselves, often doing instead everything possible
to demonstrate their power. Jesus, however, shows, not only in this occasion, but in many other instances, how true power and authority can come by way of humility. If God in human form was willing to humble himself in such a manner, then we should be more than willing to do likewise. Carrying out such acts of humility doesn't serve to diminish power and authority. As Jesus himself said to the disciples, they were right to call him teacher and Lord, as that was indeed who he was. What Peter didn't grasp at first was that Jesus choosing to wash his feet was in fact the greatest honour that he could have bestowed upon them. For far from this act diminishing Jesus' power and humbling him, it actually should have humbled Peter and instead ourselves, that Jesus wanted to claim us for his own. As Peter was finally able to understand that unless you are washed by Jesus, you can have no part of him, but that once he has, you are now able to be claimed as one of Jesus' own. Peter, in his typical, somewhat overzealous manner, replies that rather than washing simply his feet, he wants Jesus to wash every part of him. Jesus then, in his gentle manner, simply reminds Peter that if you have already been spiritually washed, then a total bath isn't required, as you are already clean in his eyes. Jesus' powerful lesson was that if he, as our Lord and Saviour, was willing to do something as seemingly lowly as washing the feet of his disciples, then what should we be willing to do for each other? As we're all very aware at this time, we are all trying to adjust this very unusual set of circumstances which we find ourselves in. This is especially true at Easter, a time where we're all used to celebrating Holy Week together. Jesus and his disciples were similarly preparing to celebrate the most holy day in the Jewish calendar, the Passover festival. And like us, they were also in a somewhat fairly somber mood. Not only was the Passover itself a reminder of a solemn event, where God protected the Israelites in captivity from the angel of death whilst they were in Egypt. On this specific occasion, the disciples had just been informed by Jesus that he would be betrayed by one of them. Jesus himself, over the course of that fateful week, was aware of the suffering that he was about to endure. As the days to Judas's betrayal got closer, and Jesus knew that his death was approaching, in the Garden of Gethsemane he even begged for the cup of suffering to be taken from him, if at all possible. But he ultimately accepted that God's will be done. The Israelites, during their captivity in Egypt, and Jesus, underwent about as severe a test as it is possible to undergo. So too, for many of us, this test that we are going through is perhaps the most difficult we have encountered in our lifetimes. As is so often the case, when difficulties arise, it can be incredibly challenging to have the strength to endure alongside the faith to overcome. It is also frequently the case that in challenging circumstances, we look to try and find understanding and clarity, but yet find the path ahead murky and difficult to decipher. In these moments when the night appears its darkest, it's also where our faith is tested the most and we appear to understand the least. It is precisely at these times and in these moments that though we do not understand, we all maintain the faith that God will always make a way, and that when we come through the other side, we understand how he was with us at every step of the journey. Holy Week is the time when we remember Jesus' greatest triumph, but before that triumph, the scale of hardship and suffering he underwent was almost unimaginable. As we too go through this Holy Week, I would implore us all to submit ourselves to God's will, perhaps knowing that as Jesus said, though we do not realize now what I am doing, later you will understand. In the meantime, as you wait through this period, which though challenging, will indeed pass, we should still look to be a blessing to each other whenever possible. As Jesus himself demonstrated, leadership is far more than the ostentatious acts which we sometimes do, but instead can often more effectively be found in the smaller acts of kindness we can all display. From calling our loved ones to ensure that they are reminded they are still in our thoughts, to even being mindful about the quantity of groceries we buy at the supermarket. These seemingly small acts of conscientiousness can help to make this period of time pass as smoothly as possible. Undoubtedly, it is easy to feel fear when faced with what we see in our world around us. But we can take comfort from the fact that not only did Jesus feel fear and so understand what we are going through, but God himself is always with us in everything we endure. This Maundy Thursday, I would like us to take heart that although we might not understand now, and it may take a long time in fact for such knowledge to be ascertained, the best thing we can do is to try and be a blessing in the interim. These small acts of kindness, though minimal on their own, collectively have a profound impact and can ensure that we carry out Jesus' instruction to us, that we love one another in the same way as he has shown love to us. Amen.
Would you like me to wash your feet?
Yes, love me to.
For old time's sake. How's that?
Very good. Thank you very much.
Between the toes.
I'm really tickled. That's what you're doing more than
I generally wash my feet.
Ready? Let's go. Should we get your trousers wet?
Oh, I'm quite ticklish. He's the between the tigers.
Okay, that's not too bad.
Shall I dry this or something?
Yeah. Lovely, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Let me be as wise for you. Dear Heavenly Father, we come before you in some despondency and fear over our situation. We need your help to get rid of this attitude and to place our trust wholeheartedly in you. In Psalm 22, verses 2 and 3, it says, O my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer, by night also, but I find no rest. Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned on the praises of Israel. We have so much to be thankful for. Primarily for our Lord Jesus Christ, who came to die for us, to bring us the gift of eternal life. We thank you too for his life, his teaching, preaching, and demonstrating your love to his disciples and to all those who met him. We thank you for the Bible, which tells the story of your rescue of the Israelite nation, as well as Jesus' life and the beginnings of the church among the early Christians. We thank you that Jesus prayed specifically for us at the Last Supper, as recorded by John. He prays not only for his disciples, but for all those who will believe in me through their message. We pray for help to remember how much you love us, so that we find it easy to pass that love on to others. Lord, we realize that Jesus must have been struggling with feelings of dread, knowing that his betrayal and death were very near. Thank you that he took the time to wash his disciples' feet to demonstrate the kind of humility and love, a love they and we should imitate. Father, help us to learn the lesson that you are always bringing good things out of bad situations. Those of us who have homes, thank you for those homes and the opportunity to spend time in them. We pray for the homeless and that good solutions may be found for them. Those of us who have kind friends who bring us food, thank you for those friends. We thank you for all who are putting themselves at risk to serve us in one way or another. We pray for the hungry, and thank you for those who contribute to food banks. We thank you especially for NHS staff and ask for your help in keeping them and their families safe. We pray for all the people in their care and all who are unwell, especially all who are facing illness alone. We thank you for families with children and for the opportunities they have to be together and learn to be happy with each other. We ask for your reassurance for the many youngsters who have had important exams cancelled this year and feel that all the study they have done is of no use. Help them to realise that with you, nothing is wasted and you have a good plan for their lives. We pray for those who can't do the jobs they need to do to live, and pray that there will be provision made for them. We pray for all members of the government, especially Boris Johnson, our Prime Minister, that they will have the good sense to turn to you, as only you can give them the guidance they need. We thank you for the information technology that enables communication, and ask for you to lend us the discretion to use it wisely. We thank you for the various charities who support folk who have fallen outside the system in this country and those suffering in refugee camps and war zones in many parts of the world. We ask for all people, especially those who wield power, to learn that, as Desmond Tutu said, good is stronger than evil, love is stronger than hate, light is stronger than darkness, life is stronger than death. Victory is ours through him who loved us.
Thank you.
And so our final prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we thank you that in this wonderful sacrament you have given us the memorial of your passion. Grant us so to reverence the sacred mysteries of your body and blood, that we may know within ourselves and show forth in our lives the fruit of your redemption. For you are alive and reign, now and forever. Amen.